Hi, and welcome to the set of About the Authors TV in Nashville, Tennessee. I'm your host, Jake Brown. We wanted to launch our fall interview season with a salute, celebration, and big thank you and shout out to the millions of teachers and professors out there who too often are the unsung heroes of many writers hearing their first words of encouragement down the path to making a living and earning a readership with them professionally. We and a few of the best-selling authors we've interviewed over the past six seasons want to say their own thank yous to you as you head out into the classrooms to begin mentoring the next generation of great writing minds.
Sure, my ninth grade English teacher is a woman named Sheila Spicer. And Miss Spicer changed my life with three words. She said to me, "You can write." And I was like, "Well, everyone can write." She said, "No, no, you know what you're doing." She said, she tried to put me in the honors class. I had some sort of conflict. She said, "Here's what we're going to do. You're going to sit in the corner for the entire year, ignore everything I do on the blackboard, ignore every homework assignment I give." And what she was really saying to me was, "You're going to thank me later." And sure enough, a decade later, when my very first novel came out, I went back to her classroom. I knocked on the door. She said, "Can I help you?" I said, "My name is Brad Meltzer. I wrote this book and it's for you." And I handed her a copy of my first novel, The Tenth Justice. And she started crying. And I said, "Why are you crying?" And she said, "You know, I was going to retire this year because I didn't think I was having an impact anymore." And I said, "Are you kidding me?" I said, "You have 30 students. We have one teacher." And that was the woman who changed my life, was Sheila Spicer, was the first person beside my family who ever told me I was good at something. So obviously, and you know, we all have in our lives that person who tells you you're good at something, that person who gives you your first real job, that person who first takes a chance on you. You owe that person forever. So when you're done listening to this, go thank them. For me, it was Miss Sheila Spicer.
I had people who encouraged me to write, and that made a really big difference. In fact, when I was 19, Ruth Graham, Billy Graham's wife, who lived up the street from us, she took me out to lunch one day and she gave me this beautiful leather journal that she just bought in Switzerland. They'd been over there. And she said, "I want you to write," because she'd read some poetry and things that I'd done. And she said, "You're very talented. You should do this." And I had English teachers that would encourage me. And I think my fourth grade teacher was really instrumental. So she used to put things, tape them up on the bulletin board. If you wrote a good story, or you drew a good picture. And those things at that very sort of impressionable stage of your life, those things are really, really important. They mean more to you than a book award you win 30 years later, really do.
It was a long time, Jake, before I learned to harness my wandering imagination in a way that was productive in literary terms. Nobody gets where they are on their own. Nobody sort of catapults themselves into success, no matter what some people like to think. You know, and I had great high school English teachers, a guy named Stephen Bach, who went on to be quite well known in his own right as an author, wrote books about Hollywood. He was very interested in film, eventually moved to Paris. A guy named Bob Boyle, who was the advisor for the newspaper, kept a good eye on me and my writing.
At Wesleyan, it was my friend and neighbor, Tony Connor, who was a poet who came from Manchester, England, who was he had several books and he was very working class, and we just loved each other. And he was the single dad and I was a single mother, and he lived one block away. And I took his poetry writing class, and he always, you know, helped and praised and encouraged. And then when I went to graduate school for my MFA at Columbia, I went because Richard Price was there, who was my hero. And I took workshop with him twice, and we would go, it was always on a Friday, and we would go to the West End and everybody would get really drunk. And then Rich and I would take a cab, he'd take a cab and he'd invite me along down the West Side, because I lived down on 12th Street and Avenue A. He lived in the West Village, and we go at the something Lion, it was a big famous writer's bar. And he'd say, "You've got a story to tell. Nobody else could tell that story. And you're, you know, be as real as you can and just really, really, really encourage me. And in fact, when I published my very first thing in the Village Voice, which, well, it wasn't the first thing, but it was the first memoir, an essay in the Village Voice, he read it and he called me up and he said, you can get an agent with this. You can get a book.
Don Zajomek is my wonderful, I adore him. And it was the same thing. I felt like he really believed in me, and we still kept in touch. He's here in Chicago, and as you can tell, he makes my face light up. And it was at Medill really where I found my people. You know, I think looking back, KU was a little too big for me. You know, it's a giant school, and I really did a lot of floating around there, and wondering if I was the only weird person there at the cake stand. It was a Medill, like all my closest friends to this day are my pals from Medill and my pals from Entertainment Weekly. And that's where, and I was like, oh, writers. That's what I've been missing, is other people who write. Yes.
I was really interested in participating in the world of literature and the world of the imagination when I was young. And so in first grade, they had this paper that was kind of horizontally shaped, and it had a place where you could put a picture, and it had a few lines where you could write a few sentences. And I wrote a gazillion stories. I remember asking other people to illustrate, because I already had some kind of idea that like someone should be illustrating my work who wasn't me. You know, games in the schoolyard as I got older, kind of role-playing games and other kind of, you know, forms of kind of what I think of as live fan fiction, of kind of, you know, taking scenarios, stitching together scenarios from things that you like and talking about them and playing them and altering the story. And that was a huge part of, I mean, it touched every part of my day, really. It was like the daydreams on the way to school, and it was the playing with friends when I was there, and it was about reading at night and telling myself stories as I drifted off to sleep. That was, it still is kind of my preferred location.
And when I was about 8 or 9, and I had this revelation that actual people wrote books, it had taken me that long to understand that the names on the spines of the books were real people who did this for a living. And I thought, wow, I could do this. And my mother, who is a rather forbidding French woman, led me into this room in our house, which was just floor to ceiling books by 19th century French novelists who all died penniless in the gutter of syphilis. And she said, and this is why you need a proper job. Teaching would be nice. So I went into teaching. And I was in teaching for 15 years, and I loved it, and I was good at it, but I just kept writing in stealth because nobody wanted to know about my writing. Nobody had anything really. It wasn't even really taught in schools. There was the odd teacher who said, oh, you write these stories. That's nice.
But in high school, I had an English teacher, Winona Garbrick was her name. She had been a WAC in World War II, and I think a sergeant. And she was about 5'1". But everybody was terrified of her because she knew how discipline worked. And even giant football players went running in terror from her. She started chastising her. And somehow she took a shine to me, and nobody had prior to this. And she saw a writing ability, and she nurtured it for 4 years that she was my English teacher. And when I chose to major in history in college, she confronted me in the hall between classes one day and said, I hear you're going to be taking history as a major. Why are you doing that? And I said, because I like history, and it's easy. And she said, that's why you're doing it. You're a born slacker. You need to take English because you have writing ability. And I changed my major. She did quite a lot to redirect my life. And then in college, I had a professor named Carl Campbell whose philosophy about life was the opposite of about everyone else I was meeting in college. And I liked his being just an outrider of things. And he woke me to the idea you didn't have to believe what everybody else believed. And it, those people who sometimes don't know the effect they've had on you in life can be profound from just the smallest of things.
I had no idea. So, of course, I tried to bounce into the English department and bounced right off the English department. I was a history major, which I enjoyed, but I didn't study art or music or writing during college at all. That said, I did have a professor who was very useful, Bruce O'Brien, my historian, academic advisor. I remember he had a very close-knit group of history students that were just obsessed. We were definitely obsessed with medieval history and writing in a specific way. And I was one of them. And I remember right as I was getting into this group, he gave me a B on a paper and I was outraged. I marched into his office and I said, "Dr. O'Brien, what is this?" And he said, "Well, that looks like a B." And I said, "It sure does." And I said, "Tell me that that someone else in that class wrote a better paper than I did." And he said, "They didn't." And I said, "Then why a B?" And he said, "Because you could write a better paper." And I have never forgotten that.
I had two tracks. Miss McConnell was my journalism teacher. I went to Glenbard West, a very enlightened school. I mean, it was high school, but there were college level courses that one could take if one had the aptitude for it, of course. And Miss McConnell was my journalism teacher. I ultimately went to the University of Missouri Journalism School because I knew I wanted to write, but I also knew I wanted to buy food and water and have a place to live. So I wanted to be practical about it. So she was someone who in her traditional role as a writer, a teacher of professional writers, she taught me proper grammar, Strunk and White, the elements of style. You know, I was in high school learning that, which students I'm sure do now, but at the time it seemed it was a little revolutionary, and taught me the structure and then allowed me to write an op-ed column for the newspaper. It was a humorous Dave Barry kind of column. So that was the one side. At the same time, Miss Virginia Gannon was my creative writing teacher. And as you say, she encouraged me to no end and encouraged me to become editor of the literary magazine, The Bard, appropriately named Glenbard West, named The Bard.
I've got to say my teachers were really indulgent. I must have been a pain in the butt. But they really put up with me. And none of them ever told me I couldn't be a writer, which is almost as valuable as saying, "Yes, you can be a writer." It's like saying, "Sure, that's possible. You know, also you could be a lion tamer." No, you know, it's really a good thing when teachers don't close doors for you. And in Tunica, Mississippi, it seemed very unlikely I would be a writer. Oh gosh, Mrs. Aust, she was my fourth grade teacher. She was great. They were all very understanding of, I must have been somewhat difficult, really, because I had a lot of imagination and I focused it all into my daily life. And that must have been a real pain for them. But they were all great. They were all great. And they all had a really high opinion of my creativity, and that was really reinforcing for me.
I began to try to write things like John Dixon Carr, who wrote historicals. He was kind of melodramatic, but he was clever. The first person on top of Mount Everest, having crawled up there on his knees, was John Wilkes Booth, who threw himself off the North Side in his guilt over assassinating Lincoln. I mean, these were the kind of things I was penning, sixth grade maybe. But the thing is, I would read them and I would say, "Wow, this is harder than I thought," because what I had written was not good. And I would put it aside and years would pass. But speaking of high school teachers, I had Mrs. Catherine Lee. She taught British literature in my senior year of high school. And this woman was lovely. She went to England every summer. She was a total Anglophile. And she ran a really tough class. And during the course of the year, we learned British literature from beginning to end. And people dodged her class because she graded hard and would wreck your grade point average. But I took her class and I started writing Elizabethan sonnets for her. And these were really terrible sonnets. They were love sonnets to a girl in the class, and she just would put on them A. She didn't have any comments whatsoever. At the bottom, she'd just put A and give them back to me. So she was very discreet. But she gave me the award for best English student at the end of the year, which the teachers would work up amongst themselves. Even though I had a bad case of senioritis and my grades slacked off in the second semester, she ignored that because she knew that I loved it. So Mrs. Catherine Lee was a crucial force. And by the time I got to college, I considered myself a poet. And that isn't exactly right. I wish it were. I love poetry and I love trying to write it. I still write it. I don't publish it very often. It's not very good compared to my novels, to tell you the honest, but it's fun to try.
I grew up in California and my parents moved me to Nashville, Tennessee when I was 14, about 2 weeks before high school. And I was dropped into Harpeth Hall, which is an all-girls Southern preparatory school there in Nashville. I was completely out of my depths. I had been going to public school in the Bay Area and I felt really lost and I felt really alone. Like I say, only child, uprooted, moved into a school where most people had known each other since age 3 or 4. And I was lonely and I couldn't find my community. I couldn't find my cadence. I couldn't find my way. And then a teacher named Scotty Gerges, who wasn't even one of my teachers, but she was my advisor. We were assigned advisors. In 10th grade, kind of noticed that I was always writing and convinced me to join the school literary magazine to try and find an outlet for it. And I would go on to graduate poet laureate for the school. And obviously my future was in writing. And so I really owe a lot to Mrs. Gerges for just seeing a struggling kid who was really lonely and looking for an outlet and noticing that I had this love of writing and really fostering it and encouraging. I felt like it was the first time that I felt seen.
There used to be before the internet, you know, they used to have these weekly publications that told you where to go and what to do. And there was a magazine in New York called Q. And Professor Wolf, I think it was Professor William Wolf, he was a movie critic at Q Magazine. And we would go to the city and he would get us into screenings as a class. And then we would kind of write reviews of the films. And that was really, really, first I met a real writer, right? And then he was a critic, which was an interesting job. And out of that connection, I began, you know, reading The Village Voice and reading New York Magazine and getting more interested in what critics did. The other person I should shout out is Alan Seeger. And he was a professor who did a class on foreign films. Now, what was important about that is through his class, again, like with William Wolf, I was learning about history. I was learning about the history of historical criticism, I guess you might say. So he showed Seven Samurai. No, he showed Yojimbo. He showed Yojimbo by Kurosawa. And then I started reading about how people wrote about that classic film. What else did we see in that class? I think probably saw my first Fellini movie in this class. And so there was this interesting thing where we would see the film, read the text, and then begin going on and writing our own essays. The one thing I really remember is I wrote an essay called Black Musical as Genre, which was because Cabin from the Sky, which was a musical from the 40s. Then I saw it somehow, I think through MoMA. MoMA used to have this thing where when you were a kid or anybody, you could go in and you could screen vintage movies in a room at MoMA. And so I saw, I think, Green Pastures from the 30s at MoMA. And sort of connected to this is I had a history of jazz class as well, which is important. I forget the professor's name. But I remember talking to him about the lyrics of Sly Stone and saying that maybe these were great lyrics. And he poo-pied, Sly. But I do, the history of jazz class was also very useful. Again, I think when I look back at the St. John's years in terms of what I got at the school, was these three, of all the things I took there, these three classes working with a real music and film critic, getting a historical look at film history, and having a history of jazz, all combined together to give me to open me up to all these different sounds and different texts.
One really big one that you may be familiar with is Robert Coover, who was my teacher in creative writing at Brown. And he was such an interesting person. Like, his stories are like, they're shaped sometimes like surfing the internet. Every possible thing happens in parallel, and then you meet back at some point that is both like impossible and contradictory and also inevitable outcome of what's come before. I don't know. They're twisty, complicated, and really fun stories. There's a sense of play in there. So, you know, I credit him with encouraging me to step into fiction when I sort of felt that I was a little bit outside of it. I felt like writing fiction required taking on this almost godlike responsibility. Like, who am I to say that this character is named this and that they're doing this, and how can I know all that? But his fiction always has this sort of arch, semi-malicious, whimsical god quality. And so I stepped into that when writing pieces and learned to, you know, try to play with what I was writing so that I wouldn't just get stuck in my own head so much. And another really big one was a teacher I had when I was at CU Boulder, who taught, his name was Bruce Kaywin, and he taught this class on the ineffable, you know, and I signed up for that class without knowing what the ineffable was. But it turns out to be all the things that I'm most interested in: the ineffability of knowing another person, the ineffability of existence. And I read Beckett for the first time in that class, which has become a lasting influence. Every single year I read Beckett's three novels again. Never gets easier, which is something that I really appreciate. But it always maintains this great balance of it's like torture, and then it's also quite funny.
I had a science teacher, Mrs. Camone. She was tops, ace. My basketball coach, Mickey Spinelli, and another instructor. I had a couple, you know, Mr. Smart, and a football coach who was young at the time when I, you know, because he had just come into the, just got out of the Marine Corps, just come into the system, Ron Fredericks. So I had a lot of good people that guided, you know, that not only guided me, but guided other individuals in my situation that were athletes. They took interest in making sure we got our schoolwork done and stayed on the straight and narrow. I mean, it was a good relationship that the instructors, the teachers had with the students back then.
The teacher that made the greatest impact on me through books was my 10th grade American history teacher, Mark Johnson. I grew up in the South, and he's a white man. And one day he just gave me the autobiography of Malcolm X and said, "You should read this." I don't know what he saw in me or what, you know, why he did that. I didn't read it right away, teenager, you know, but I was 2 years later, I was taking the train from Florida to New Haven to go to Yale. And I read the book for the, you know, the length of the time it took me to was that 20 hours or something? And I was totally radicalized by the time I got off the train. So it didn't lead me to becoming a writer directly, you know, but it definitely raised my political and social awareness and consciousness. One of the really transformative classes that I took at Yale was called Blacks and the Law. And it was taught by Judge Fleming Norcott. What a great name, right? That's a very literary name, Fleming Norcott. Black, he's a black man. And he, at the time, was, he still may be a Connecticut Supreme Court judge. And so he was that professor that was very, you know, kind of stern and serious, and you made sure that you always came prepared and that you didn't say anything stupid. And then, but he also had this other side to him where if you could write or recite the rhyme of the Ancient Mariner, you got bonus points. Like he wanted us to memorize that poem. And, you know, I maybe there was a connection to Blacks in the Law and it went over my head, or I just don't remember, but you know, he stuck out to me for that reason.
I started as a chemistry and physics guy and I was really good at that stuff. And I got like scholarships for that. And I had this writing bug. I think that really came on strong when I was like 18 or 19. But I was terrified of switching from chemistry and physics to English because I thought I would never make any money. And, you know, we'll see. but I had a professor, he was so wonderful. And I wrote, it was my first paper for his class. It was a big modernism, kind of like Joyce and Proust and all these great books. And I wrote my first paper and then like the TA pulled it out and gave it to him. And then he wrote me like a note back on it. And then he read some bits of it out to the class, which was like 200 people. And I was this like physics major and I was so like worried because I kind of wanted to do English, but I didn't know if I was any good at it. I was almost scared that they would encourage me because then I would like get away from a career where I would just be like an engineer somewhere with a salary and into this, you know, how am I going to make a living thing? But that encouragement was really helpful, incredibly helpful. And actually that at different times over my career, it's been, I've gotten like little bits of encouragement at exactly the right time to help me like make the leap because I'm actually probably a little bit more conservative, like temperamentally than a lot of people who get into careers writing or in the arts, you know? So it's always worked out that somebody gives me just the right encouragement when I need it.
Nobody in particular, but there was a lot of general encouragement where it was made clear to me early on that this was a thing I was good at. And of course, as a kid, if people start to say, oh, you're good at this, especially when you're really not good at things like sports, and they start you saying you're really good at a writer, it makes you want to do it more. So I did a lot of writing in elementary school, in high school, and got a lot of encouragement for it.
In elementary school and high school, and had a English teacher, Mrs. Hunt, who spent a lot of time with me working through classic texts. And she told me one day, said, you know, I think you can make a living as a writer someday. But Mrs. Hunt, my junior English teacher, was the first person that ever sort of gave me the, you know, planted the seed in my head that I could probably do this for a living.